Dobry wieczór Państwu. Witam Państwa serdecznie na...
Good evening.
Dobrze, na czwartym już spotkaniu z...
I'd like to welcome you to the fourth meeting in our series on the reorientalization of Islam. For those of you who are with us for the first time, allow me to briefly say a few words about the series itself before I move on to the introduction of our guest. The series was designed as a sort of reflection on contemporary Islam, Muslim culture, the Arab world, in its different aspects. One of our first meetings was devoted to contemporary Islam, modern Islam, and we asked whether such a thing existed, what it was like. Our second meeting was about the embroilment of the media in the discussion around Islam and Muslim communities. The third meeting was a meeting with Tahar Benjaloun. We talked about literature and culture. This evening, it is my pleasure to introduce Hossein Darashan in Warsaw after practically 6 months of exchanging emails and discussing what this evening would be like, what we would be talking about. We were able to finalize this visit. And the reason why we invited Hossein was because of his text, which made quite a splash in The Guardian at the end of 2015, in which Hossein openly and indeed brutally does away with the social media and discusses various threats or dangers of those media that follow from their global reach. I have the impression that maybe that article was not in fact the reason for this visit, but it sort of lays out the general topic that we want to discuss. Some months later, The Economist also published a controversial article about the imperial goals of Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook, their drive for power, and this sort of reflection is only reaching Poland. We're still quite enthralled to social media, admiring their agency, the agency that they give us, the powers that they give us. Meanwhile, Hossein persuades us, and I think he is successful. I myself am persuaded that social media are a type of bubble in which we function. So hopefully tonight I will also ask a number of questions about the usefulness of Facebook. And tonight's meeting is called From the Hyperlink to Emojis, How the Social Media Have Changed the Internet into Television.
Witam Państwa i dziękuję za przyjście. Okay, my name is Hossein Darakhshan. I don't need this anymore. Thanks for inviting me, Konrad, and I'm very glad to be here in Warsaw. So far it's been an amazing experience and I really like the city and I'm looking forward to coming back and maybe even live here for a while and work. I live in Tehran, so I directly came from Tehran this time. And it's great to be in Eastern Europe. I'm going to answer a few questions, basically, in my presentation. These are the questions. After 25 years, since the web came into existence, Is there a shift in the discourse that dominates the internet and the web or not? That's the first question. Then, what are the signs of this shift? What is this shift? And then, why this shift has happened? Then the answer, the question is, what are the consequences of this shift? And then how we can resist this shift, and if there is any hope for any way out of the current situation. Then I'm going to show you a video, an 8 minutes video, which actually summarizes everything that I've said. And then we'll have questions and answers. I'm going to start with the first question. Is there a shift in the discourse that dominates the internet and web? So I'm going to talk about how things were. In 1991, when the first website was created by Tim Berners-Lee at CERN, since 91 and until today, it's been 25 years, and we've seen many, many things happening. First, we had the web for many years, almost until around 2004-5. We had websites on the one side, and on the other hand, we had many blogs, which were actually the most mature and sophisticated form of the web in many ways. Mainly because it embodied the soul of the web, which was hypertext. And the reason for that was that blogs were using hyperlinks in order to connect different kinds of text, different pieces of text that existed on the internet. So we had blogs everywhere in the world, including in Iran. Blogs were really popular and important. There were lots of different kinds of debates happening in blogs in Iran and everywhere in the world. And I'm sure some of you might have had blogs. If there is anyone, please raise your hands if you've had blogs. Are you still writing them? Not anymore. When did you stop? When? Stop. You haven't stopped, but you have. Recently. So yes, a lot of blogs have disappeared or have stopped to be updated, and that's a reality. This is what the shift is about. When the web was so popular, and when everything basically was online during these years, during these 20 years almost, you had websites by magazines, newspapers, you had blogs, you had discussion forums, and everything was text-based. That was a very big difference to now. And when we talk about text and typography, we actually talk about thinking and rationality and arguments and sophisticated, complicated ideas, because text is the biggest achievement in human civilization and in human history, in that it is still able and capable to convey complex and sophisticated messages. It's the most sophisticated form of communication in many ways. And it has amazing capacities. And the whole idea of the Enlightenment, which was created and based on the idea of reason, was impossible without the centrality of text and typography. So what has changed now is we can all feel something has changed. And this was my case as well, because in 2008, I went back to Iran and I was imprisoned, and I was imprisoned for 6 years because of my political activities and writings and all that. And before that, I had a very popular blog in Persian, and I had one in English, and it was an amazing time in discussing different topics, different issues, and it had such an effect on the society everywhere, especially in Iran, because blogs, for the first time, I think, in history, they democratized writing, and this was quite a significant moment for the history of Iran and the society and politics. Because before that, everyone who wanted to publish something, they needed permissions from government. And this has been the case, I'm sure, in many, many countries. So blogs, in a way, because they made publishing easy, were helping democracies, open democracies everywhere in the world, including Iran. But what has changed ever since is, I would call it a shift from typography-centeredness or text-centeredness to image-centeredness. And I'm going to explain why I'm saying this shift has happened. When I came out of prison in 2014, I realized that Facebook is not something that I remembered from before I went to jail. Because in 2008, I think Facebook was more a tool, an instrument to connect with your friends and family. You could have their contacts there, like an address book. And actually, this is where the name comes from, because Facebook, in the US apparently, there is a tradition of universities publishing yearbooks or directories of all the students with their names and a picture accompanying that those names, and they would publish them yearly. So people would be able to collect these directories, and then they would be able to connect with their friends or classmates. This was the idea of Facebook, and actually it started from Harvard University, Harvard, and then it expanded only to universities around the world. So if you didn't have an email address, an academic email address, you were not able to register on Facebook. And this was the case until around 2006 or 2007, when they opened it up to everyone. But even after the opening up, it was still limited to this kind of activity, which was connecting people to each other. It didn't have the function that it has now as a gatekeeper, as a news aggregator, as something that is affecting so many people so much that over 50% of the population in India and Brazil think that Facebook is the internet. So this is how it has changed from something from a directory of friends or classmates to something that's dominating society and politics and many aspects of our lives. So when I came out, I discovered that this is not... First of all, I discovered that blogs are dead almost. Very few people kept writing their blogs and updating them. This was a big shock. And then I realized that the reason for that is that gradually people have moved to Facebook. The readers of these blogs have moved to Facebook. And the authors of these blogs wanted to reach them. So they also went on Facebook to be able to share or to put a link to their blogs. But then soon, quickly, they realized that this is not working very well. So they started to post their own blog posts on Facebook itself, instead of putting up links to their blog posts on their websites, on their blogs. So gradually this led into the death of many blogs on different domain names, on different blogging services. that are still there, but it looks like a graveyard with tombs, with the names of the authors and the bloggers on them. And they haven't been updated anymore. Then I started trying Facebook as a publishing platform. I wrote something, and because I had this relatively big audience before I went to jail, and when I was a successful blogger in many ways, I was expecting the blog the Facebook posts to become popular and to receive likes and shares very quickly, but that wasn't the case, which actually shocked me. At the same time, it raised many questions. I started thinking, and then after a while, I realized why this has happened. And this is the main reason for the shift. The hyperlink, which was the foundation of the web, was being dismissed and was being disrespected on social networks. And the reason is economy. Because their monetizing strategy is advertising, and if they keep you as long as possible on within their own platform, within their own space, then of course they would be able to show you more posts, more advertisings, and more promoted material. So this had happened, and this had caused all these social networks to be not very friendly towards hyperlinks, because hyperlinks would take people outside those platforms. Twitter is still quite friendly towards hyperlinks, but even Twitter is not enabling you to put to highlight a piece of text and only link those words to an outside source. You have to put a link separately. This is also true with Facebook, but Facebook is even worse because it only allows you to put almost one link, and it highlights that link and it make a nice little card with it, and then people, it encourages people to click on that. But actually, it doesn't encourage them to click on it, because now it has introduced, for the past year, I think, it has introduced something called instant articles, which means that, you know, that magazines and newspapers are encouraged to create a certain type of web page, so Facebook can host them on its own servers and quickly opens it when someone clicks on these links. So it looks as if you have been transferred to that website, but that's not actually the case. It's just hosted on Facebook, and the information is also on Facebook servers, and that's why it quickly opens up. It doesn't go to the original website. Then there are also secret things that we don't necessarily know, because they happen behind the scenes, and it's basically preventing linked material to appear in people's news feeds as much as other materials, other original materials. This has been studied, and people have realized, researchers have realized, that if you post something original, it would be more likely to be seen in people's news feeds than if you put up a link to the same text on an outside website. So that's the key thing. The hyperlink, which was the guarantee for diversity, because you would be able to go to different sites and you would start browsing something from point A, and then you would end up opening many, many tabs, and you would end up somewhere that you didn't even plan to visit as a result of hyperlinks. That was the case when we were using Firefox that enabled us to open different tabs for the first time, and it changed the way actually we communicated with the web, and we browsed the web. They were also providing a kind of non-linearity, which is very important in everything as a discourse, because the non-linearity is something that is probably unnatural to our brains, but for a while, when hypertext and hyperlinks were in full effect, we were not thinking linearly. we would be able to quickly change the path of our thoughts, to go to a different place with a different look, with a different design, with different font and typography and colors and graphic design, and even topic. In terms of topic, we would be transferred from this topic to another topic. It was an amazing experience for a while. Maybe unnatural, as I said, to our brains, but it was quite fascinating. It was expanding, and it was actually helping some sort of capabilities in our heads and in our brains that didn't exist before. And it was actually based on the idea of hypertext, which was developed in the 1960s as within the literary theory and literary circles by Ted Nelson, I think. So this was the embodiment of that vision in World Wide Web, and especially in blogs. And if you remember, blogs had a few other features. One of them was archive, the idea of archive, which ironically doesn't exist anymore. If you pay attention to all these social networks, they have search, but they don't have archives. And there is a huge difference between search and archive, because for search, you have to know what you want. But if you don't know what you want, this is where archives were useful. You were just reading different things from a different time without necessarily knowing what kind of keywords you were looking for. So the social networks have damaged the idea of hyperlinks, and this has consequences. The consequence, when it's combined with something called the stream, which is the logic of representing these informations and representing these posts, and for example, newsfeed is an example of these streams, you would have a completely different experience. First of all, the stream works based on an algorithm. And now, the dominant form of algorithms, because you can have many types of algorithms based on different rules and different social values, but the ones that are dominant now, especially on Facebook and other social networks, are based on two social values that actually dominate our time, in a way. One is popularity. Anything that is popular is only seen if they receive enough likes and shares, like a popularity contest. And anything that is new or is happening now, the nowness or the newness. So you have the popularity and the newness as the two underlying social values of these algorithms that dominate social networks now. So this is making the whole experience of the internet in a very peculiar and different way. We used to read blogs, and when you read blogs, when you started to look at a blog, you would read everything from top to bottom. And they were actually they were represented based on dates, reverse chronology. That was the type of representation on blogs. So it didn't matter if one post had more comments or was more viewed or less. You would see all of them if you logged on to any of these blogs. But now, the consequence of these algorithms is that if your post is not popular enough, it wouldn't be seen in other people's news feeds. So imagine you have an opinion that is in minority. For example, if you like certain kinds of music or certain kinds of films, or if, for example, you support certain kinds of political views that are in minority, these algorithms are not helping you to be seen or heard. So they create a kind of cocoon or a comfort zone. I would call them comfort cocoons, because everyone feels comfortable within them as a result of these algorithms working based on your habits. Anything that is habitual, anything that you actually have been used to, is only going to be shown to you. You are rarely surprised, because it works based on what you've already liked. So basically, everyone within their own beliefs and prejudices, those kinds of beliefs would be reinforced and radicalized. So imagine you're a minority person in any ways, and these algorithms would only reinforce and radicalize whatever you are already. So think of ISIS, for example, or other religious radical groups, or nationalist groups even. So in a way, Facebook is helping these kinds of radical ideas by making them less heard and by making them more radical. That is happening to all of us. We are rarely exposed to different opinions. We are rarely challenged by different opinions and different views because of these algorithms. And this is a very dark future. And actually, it's not the future, it's now. It's happening now before our eyes. So then the other reason, apart from hyperlinks, for this shift is mobile phones. The line between offline and online world is blurred as a result of smartphones, because we carry them all the time. The term virtual world doesn't mean anything anymore, because we are dealing with the consequences of offline world in our online existence. So as a result, it's also another reason, basically, that hyperlinks are not very popular anymore, because it's hard on cell phones and on smartphones to open links and to open different tabs and try to browse the web the way we used to on our laptops and desktops. This is probably another reason. So these reasons have resulted in a different kind of experience now. The internet used to be about text, and it used to be about reason and rationality and debate. But now, with the dominance of social networks and the mode of communication that they promote, which is very linear, which is very centralized, which is very passive, and which is very very much against diversity, because they don't promote links. This new experience is very much like television. And that's why I am dividing, and I'm saying that there has been a shift from books-internet to TV-internet, which is about emotions, entertainment. And then you have all these videos as well, and images, which is making this whole experience a very image-dominated experience. So this has been the shift from reason to entertainment, from rationality to emotions. And when you see the signs are actually quite fascinating. You can't agree or disagree with a Facebook post. You can like it, or you can share your feelings about it with those little emojis. They're not open to falsification. They're not open to discussions, because they're images. Even if there is text, it is treated as image, because you would only be able to show your emotions again about it. This is an amazing sign. Oh, you can't say this is true or false. It's not open. This is not an open question when it comes to social networks. You would only be able to say that you like it or not. And then you also have the idea of prime time on social networks. Have you ever tried to tweet around 10 a.m., or 3 p.m., have you realized that you wouldn't get enough likes or shares when you do that? There is a specific time on all these social networks where you would be most viewed and visible. Very similar to the idea of prime time on television, from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. So the idea of prime time now is even applied to social networks. And this is fascinating. Another very good example of how the new internet is resembling television. So this leads us into probably rethinking the consequences of television, in a way, the socio-political consequences and implications of the emergence and the dominance of television. Because now I think the internet is very similar to television, and I would say Facebook is the future of television. And I'm sure that we would soon see better signs for that. And I'm going to tell you how. So this shift, as I said, has been caused by the decline of links, the rise of mobile phones, smartphones. And then there is another reason for this shift, which is the economy, in a way. The middle class is shrinking everywhere in the world as a result of the very radical capitalist system that is now dominating everywhere in the world as a result of the collapse of the Soviet Union. Because when the Soviet Union existed, the West was very afraid of the attraction of the socialist ideas, and that's why they were doing their best to promote welfare states and social security and many other types of strategies and economic formations that would basically and ultimately create a healthy work and life balance. So now this is disrupted. Anywhere in the world, people have to work much, much longer than 40, 50 years ago. So obviously, it's definitely a given that after working so much and for such long hours, you wouldn't be able to read and focus, and you wouldn't have the energy to read anything sophisticated and complicated. So of course, you would like to watch YouTube videos and Facebook videos and television. This is another probably larger reason. Sociopolitical reasons for this shift. So now with this shift, we have a new class of illiterates. The decline of text and the decline of typography and the rise of videos and television everywhere means that there is a big majority in every society now who are not even capable of reading anything difficult or complex or sophisticated more than maybe 1-2 paragraphs. This is what we are all seeing now and probably are all experiencing. Once you finish college, it's really rare that you start reading a nonfiction, a complex nonfiction. Which wasn't the case. This book, written by Neil Postman, Amusing Ourselves to Death, explained this very, very well. He talks about the American society from the 16th to 19th century, and he says New England on the East Coast had the most educated and literate people probably on the planet at the time. He explains how popular very complex books were at the time. The best example that he actually talks about is from Thomas Paine's book called Common Sense, which was published in 1776. And in 2 months after it was published in January, it was sold for 100,000 copies within a population of 3 million people. So the equivalent of that would be 10 million copies of that book, which was a very complex and complicated and sophisticated book about political theory, and he was one of the American revolutionaries. 10 million books in 2 months were sold, the equivalent now would be. And the whole, during that year, the book was sold for 300,000 copies, which would be equal to 30 million copies now. Imagine that. Imagine what kind of society existed in the US and in many other parts of the world because of the monopoly, actually, that typography had. Because when the printing press emerged in the 16th century, until around 19th century, there was nothing else people could actually do other than reading. And this started from reading books, and then it was expanded into reading articles and newspapers. But that was it. There was nothing else. But it had consequences. So then telegraph emerged in 1840 by Samuel Morse. But the difference between this type of text, which was promoted, which was actually conveyed by telegraph, compared to the former type of text that existed before in the form of books and newspapers, it was a different kind. It was irrelevant in a way that it didn't really affect people's lives when they were receiving telegraphs. They were sort of chaotic, irrelevant pieces of information coming from different parts of the world or from different parts of the country that didn't really affect people's lives. And when they turned, when they were transformed into news, they became a commodity. This was the first time that text, in that sense, was becoming a commodity. They were also impotent. They were also impotent because they were not able to encourage you to do anything. Everyone felt incapable. They were reading, they were receiving all these terrible news about disasters or negative events and happenings, and everyone felt incapable of doing anything. The maximum thing that anyone could do was to participate in elections. This was another feature of telegraph. And then they were also incoherent because they didn't have a context. The format of the language with those specific kind of headline type of sentences were really not saying anything concrete, anything substantial. You couldn't argue, you couldn't make arguments, you couldn't create propositions, and to make a complex, even historicizing piece of information with those telegraphs. Then television emerged in the 1950s, and it became dominant. So when television emerged, nobody was exchanging ideas anymore. They were exchanging images. Politics was reduced to a reality show, which is actually happening now, and we can see it in the most radical form with Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton's competition to win the presidential elections in the US. If you watch CNN, you would be laughing if instead of these two people, where there were two kids, for example. The whole process of elections has become like a reality show. And ironically, Donald Trump was the product of a reality show. And now, with the help of television, he's going to become the president of the most televised society in the world. I don't think there is any population that is watching more television for the older generation and for the younger generation videos on YouTube and Facebook, because I think they are the same. There's no other population that is watching more television, new or old, than the US. And this is such an irony, the shift from the 16th to 19th century, where the US had the most literate population compared to now. So something similar has also happened in the internet, I would argue, because I see blogs as the first phase of the age of typography. Then I would see Twitter as the equivalent of Telegraph, and then the emergence and dominance of Facebook as something parallel to the emergence of television. This is a very interesting parallel, I think. So, from the questions that I was supposed to discuss, now we reach to the final one, which is there any hope? Is there any way to resist this speedy process of televisation of the internet and the dominance of television? But before that, I would also like to address this, that for newspapers and for text-based media, when television emerged, a kind of crisis started for them. Their circulation was going down and people were reading less and less because television was replacing book reading or newspaper reading. But then the web emerged, and because it was a text-dominated space, there was a new hope for anyone who was into text and producing text. So newspapers were happy. There was a window of opportunity where they all used it. They didn't even really care about print anymore. So their circulation was still going down, but they didn't care because they had a new space where, on the web, where they could reach a much wider audience, and they could actually even compensate financially for the loss of print versions, because they could publish advertising to a degree that wasn't possible when they were printing their material. But then, suddenly, the web is disappearing and the newspapers are in the worst kind of crisis now. They are all closing down their offices outside, international offices. Many of them are reducing the number of their newsrooms, staff, and on the other hand, ironically, they're expanding their video sections. So a kind of polarized shape we are observing within the media now. You would either, in the next few years, I think you would see that more crystallized. You would see many newspapers who would actually try to cater for that small elite minority who would still be reading, and actually these are the ones who would be reading long-form journalism, who would be reading reports with 6,000 words, and then you would have a majority of people who would be watching videos, so these newspapers and magazines would have to create a video section. So they would have to either become, or maybe simultaneously, book publishing platforms in a way, or video publishing platforms, and anything that is in between, which is basically the big part of any newspaper's activity now. Articles and stories with 800 words or 1,000 words and that kind of thing is already disappearing because they're not being read as much as long-form ones or videos. And this is a very interesting shift as well. The new illiteracy, I would call it. So how can we resist? I would have three suggestions on three levels. On a personal level, I think we can, this is what we can. I don't think we can do anything more than this. We can actually disrupt these algorithms to confuse them. So they wouldn't be able to give us anything based on our habits. And by that, as an example, I mean we can start liking what we actually dislike. Or if there was a dislike button, which I think maybe one day would emerge, we can actually dislike what we actually like. This way, they would be confused and they wouldn't be feeding us with what we have already liked and what we're used to. Or examples like this you can think of. On a social level, we can put pressure on these companies that are dominating many aspects of our lives now to change their algorithms, to make them more diverse, to make them less... to make them less inclined to show majority views, to end this tyranny of majority, and to end this tyranny of whatever is new and present. So basically to encourage them to come up with different kinds of algorithms based on different kinds of values. And I think it's possible. I'll give you one example. We all love DJs, and DJs are doing something completely different and opposite of these algorithms, because they bring out old things, old pieces of music, so there's nothing, you know, the nowness or the newness doesn't matter in that sense. And they are bringing out stuff that were completely unknown. They were not even popular, but we all love what they do. So other kinds of algorithms that would replicate or would do something similar to what DJs do is also possible if there are more imaginative and if there are enough social pressure on them to do that. Then on the highest level and on top of Slayer level, we would have, I think we would need to ask the states to intervene. Because now the social networks are affecting many aspects of our lives that representative governments were supposed to take control of or to be in charge of. So they would, at some point, I think the governments would have to force these companies to open up their algorithms to actually make transparent what kind of posts or what kind of topics they prioritize, they privilege, and they would have to set some sort of minimums and maximums for diversity, for many of these negative aspects. And I don't think it's impossible, because we're already seeing states intervening in, for example, in racial diversity, in gender diversity, when it comes to company and employment. So why wouldn't the same logic be applied to social networks in order to make their algorithms less dangerous in suppressing diversity and minorities and all that? And then arts could also be very helpful in the way that it can actually wake people up, contemporary arts especially, performance arts, installation, things that would happen on the street and it would happen in public places, in order to remind people how dangerous this world is becoming as a result of something that looks like entertainment but is actually affecting the society as a whole, more than anything else probably now. So, to summarize everything that I just said, I'm going to show you now a video which I made a few months ago in Tehran. It's an 8-minute video, and it recaps everything that I said now, and then we will have questions and answers afterwards.
Absent from life, but it is an entire era online. This is the Six years is a long time to be absent from life. but it is an entire era on Lyre. This is the story of a man who spent 6 years in prison in Iran over his web activities, and when freed, found an entirely different internet. I am Hossein Darakhshan. I was freed from jail in November 2014. I used to have a popular blog called Editor Myself, and because of my serious efforts to promote blogs, they gave me the funny title of Blog Father here. Tehran has changed a lot during this time. Many old houses are replaced by high-rise luxurious condos. There are new roads, new highways, and many, many big SUVs. There are numerous large billboards with advertising for Swiss-made watches and Korean flat-screen TVs. And everybody seems more colorful and stylish, especially women. And hundreds of new cafes have opened up with Western music and female staff. This was all a huge surprise to me. The most shocking thing for me was how the internet had changed. I had heard about social networks' importance and I knew that now everybody used them. What I didn't know was that they had not just killed blogging as I knew it, but also they had stolen most of our readers. Writing and publishing in social media was not much different from writing in a blog, but getting your posts read, or at least viewed by them, had become a big challenge. I started my blog, a new one, in Persian, about books and ideas, and I knew that I had to share it on social media, so I shared it on Facebook and Twitter. But in the first few days, it only received 4, 5, 6 likes. I started to think and reflect, and I used social networks to share my thoughts. Gradually, I realized that blogs are practically dead, and the reason for that was not the social networks per se. It was their treatment of hyperlinks and the philosophy behind their algorithms of representation, or what is now called the stream. Facebook's newsfeed is a stream. The idea is that not everyone's posts are interesting for you. So Facebook's algorithms pick the ones that are more recent and they have already received some likes, and they're about topics that you've already shown an interest in. In other words, the stream equates importance with newness and popularity. This is exactly like the real world, where youth and fame, or better to say, young celebrities, have dominated our cultures. Sadly, the once utopian virtual world is finally catching up with the depressing rules of the real world. Meanwhile, social networks are obsessively trying to keep us inside. So they are not big fans of hyperlinks, which take their users outside. Some like Instagram are simply preventing hyperlinks. Others like Facebook are degrading the hyperlink. Facebook only allows one link in a post, which is separate from the text, not part of it. It then treats that link like an object rather than a relation between inside and outside. It strips the hyperlink of its diversifying and decentralizing power. The rise of the stream and the fall of hyperlinks have resulted in a very different internet compared to 6 years ago. Web pages outside social networks are dying, and there are less and less people who are clicking on links in their newsfeed. They're also much less exposed to different opinion than before. Because of this tyranny of the popular, minority views are quashed and they are being radicalized as a result. The truth is that the internet is much less diverse now. Apart from deviating from the web's diverse nature, the internet is also becoming quite centralized with social networks. Now, huge amounts of user-generated content is kept within social networks gigantic databases. We hardly own what we produce, and the risk of losing them is very high. Also, we are giving so much detail about our preferences that we have become extremely predictable to states and big corporations. And predictability means control. A recent study shows that Facebook can know you better than your parents with only 150 likes, and even better than your spouses with 300 likes. I think human race has never been so naked and so powerless. Blogs used to be the closest form to the vision of Tim Berners-Lee, who invented the World Wide Web. They provided a non-sequential, decentralized, active, and diverse way of representing information. With Facebook, blogs are dead. Now the internet is defined not by an interconnected collection of websites, but by a series of disconnected and centralized social networks and mobile apps that are gradually making web browsers irrelevant.
The web started from academia. It involved lots of thinking, reading, and debating. It had an unprecedented intellectual power. But now the social networks are making it more of entertainment. This centralized, linear, programmed, and inward-looking medium is not the internet as we knew it. It is television.
When we log on to Facebook, our personal television starts broadcasting, with more and more still and moving images or short paragraphs of text. And it all is individually tailored for us according to our preferences. Perhaps there is no way to save the web. The shift from what I call library internet to TV internet is sadly inevitable, as billions of people are connecting. After all, television is one of the few cultural forms that is still rapidly growing all around the world. It now dominates media, arts, and even politics.
But that doesn't mean we have to give up. If we care about peace in our complicated world, and if we know about the great potentials that the internet had, we need to resist and fight to keep that vision alive.
Hossein, thank you very much for your very disturbing vision of nowadays and near future. And I hope you enjoy it. And I open it to questions from the floor. If there is a question, yes, I will provide the microphone.
I have one technical observation. There is one other way that Facebook is killing hyperlink, because when you put a hyperlink on Facebook, it is not the hyperlink that you are putting there. It looks like, but yeah. But in reality, it is own Facebook hyperlink that is linking you to other page of Facebook, and then from this page you are transformed into the original page. Yeah. But I want to share my own way of coping with the overflow of information at the Facebook. That was my very early intuition how Facebook worked, and I see now that it was very proper. I have separate two accounts. One is for friends, people that I know personally, and other is for all the other stuff. Pages of right-wing, pages of Nazis, pages of left-wing people, organizations, of New York Times, economists, all other. And this flow is completely different from the flow of my friends. And it really makes a completely different experience of the social media in this way.
Yeah, that's true. But you know that it's illegal based on its terms and conditions to have two personal accounts.
I have three questions, actually, but I want to put them very short. One is about the future of the social networks. Now we are so much focused on Facebook, but there is a fact that new generations, I mean teenagers, they are not really interested in Facebook because of a very simple reason, because Facebook is where their parents and their teachers are there. So they don't want to be there. They don't want to be seen by their previous generation. So if for their parents' generation, Facebook is the serious place to be and Instagram is the non-serious place to be, like putting pictures of food and stuff, for this generation, Instagram is the serious place to be and less serious place is Snapchat and places like this. So what is your opinion about, because these people are going to be the future users of social network and stuff, so how do you, what is your opinion about this new generations?
They don't even know what hyperlink is because Instagram doesn't allow.
Yeah, exactly. And they're too lazy to copy paste it on their browser.
Yeah, you can't copy it from your phone. You cannot select any.
Maybe
text
you can just write it.
Yeah.
On a piece of paper. Yeah. The other thing is you said about how state and authority can intervene the social medias. We have two examples of how authoritarian regimes, they intervene. One is in Iran, that Facebook is banned, and many similar social medias. But then this needs of social media Inc. is growing in the other ways. And on the other hand, we have China, that they have this ultimate form of social media, which I forgot the name, but it's not just the Facebook, but you can do your banking transactions in it, you can order your food, you can make your So, but at the same time, this is just one platform which is controlled by the authority. So authority can see you, whatever you are doing, and check your financial stuff. So in one hand, we have the ban of the social network. On the other hand, we have this ultimate form of social network controlled by the authority. So what do you think about this? And well, that's enough.
Obviously an invitation for intervention by governments would be misunderstood by some, but they are the ones who are already doing as much as they can to control these social networks. Because they have powers and they have the capacity to organize movements, and this is why they're scared of these things. But now I think, I'm not really sure if they have the same kind of capability anymore, now that it's become more about entertainment. I mean, if governments are scared of a video to be shown on Facebook, what's the difference between people seeing it on television, on CNN, for example, or on Facebook? So I think part of their fear is unnecessary. And it's just because it's new that they're scared of. But I think if the demand for more transparency when it comes to algorithms and the strategies of gatekeeping, basically, if that is encouraged and if that happens in the West, I think it would be good for democracy. It would be good for the principles of an open democratic representative system.
I remember my last. What do you think about audio podcasts as a kind of? It's a kind of radio, but like an audio blog, actually.
I like them, and I think they are. It's one of the only positive news now, when it comes to the new media. The rise of podcasts is, I think, is promising because it's somewhere between text and video, and it has some intellectual capacity to it that the video doesn't have. So I think it's a good sign. But still, even podcasts, the serious podcasts, are not listened by the masses. They are again limited to the same people who would be reading books and complex long form articles, unless they are about entertainment, unless they're entertainment podcasts.
Thank you.
There's another question.
Hello. Do you have any thoughts on YouTube that you could share? Because I observed interested in the phenomenon of YouTubers that play games. I watch a lot of them. And
what kind of games?
Many types of games like Counter-Strike, Minecraft,
So
on.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's a huge phenomenon. There are like really millions of views of these videos. And so there's a new army of vloggers. So do you have any thoughts on this? Any comparison? Because, you know, these are usually that like the young people who start their channels. And so this is like a new kind of blogger army. But they just use a different... they just do the videos and they discuss, they debate, they sometimes talk to each other. So I wonder whether it's like a new thing, a new like a blogging 2.0. And so it's not that blogging is dead.
I didn't understand. Where are they? Where do they produce content?
They share it on YouTube. They're just YouTubers. So
why do you call them bloggers?
Because they not only play the video games, they share those videos, but they also discuss many other aspects. They just do.
How do they discuss them? Do they?
They just sit
talk
in
to
front
the camera.
Of, yeah, they talk to the camera, and sometimes there are two of them because they work as a network, but they sometimes join and have the video that are like two guys and they are discussing, or they are like debating that one guy has a video and another in another guy's video the other one is responding to okay. the first one. So there is a kind of debate in this phenomenon. So any
yeah.
thoughts?
The first example of people playing computer games, it's no different from people watching football or basketball or any other kinds of games, because when you are watching somebody playing something with somebody else and you're not participating in it, why would it be anything different? And then the second form of talking head kind of format is very similar to what has been all around television for a long time, when you have different shows run by different people. For example, Fox News has some shows named after the presenters where they actually do the same thing. They start talking to the camera, and sometimes it's actually even more interactive than some of these video blogs because they sometimes take video phone calls from people. And then you would have another presenter on the CNN or another channel who would be producing the same format in response or in reaction sometimes to what was on Fox News. But I wouldn't say that's anything serious. I think it's still more about entertainment because the form doesn't use text. The form is not a word-based kind of communication mode, because this is where they are different. It's not about what they say. It's about a discourse that video and television enforces, and this is how it's actually shaped by the conventions of television and TV. As Neil Postman says, serious television is always bad television. Nobody watches those things. And good television is the shallowest and the most emotionally involving kind of programs. And I think that's true. If these things are played on television, nobody would be watching them. And even online, if you compare the number of people, the number of views, compared to something more entertaining, it would be nothing. It would have such little impact, I would say.
Yeah, just one comment that that there is the opposite thing, that those guys start with entertaining their viewers because it's about playing, but then they start producing the content that is very serious and they start sharing their really serious opinion on very serious topics. So it's kind of like opposite to what you say.
So you don't seem to you don't seem to be a big fan of videos, but don't you think that there's a difference between the videos produced on YouTube and the television format of videos that we used to have? For instance, nowadays we've got so many serious kind of videos that are not entertainment at all. For example, there's a YouTube channel, they're teaching history, for example, week by week, 100 years after the First World War, and it's very serious and it's got hundreds of thousands of views. And there's many similar video channels like that on YouTube, from tutorials, how to learn a certain skill, to learning about philosophy, history, and there's so many serious material out there as well. So don't you think that, and you can choose, and you've got this option to choose, and sometimes YouTube even helps you because the same algorithm kind of knows what you're interested in, so you can find out more interesting stuff. So don't you think that there is a positive side to it as well as all the drawbacks that we mentioned? Plus, that there are some simplified versions. I don't know if you know AJ Plus, that is by Al Jazeera.
Yeah.
So, and they've got interesting like viewpoint and stance on things. And it has become very popular among young people. And I know it's a very simplified version of news, but it's news anyway, and it can attract young people. So don't you think that it has certain kind of positive sides as well as the negative sides?
Of course. Video can be used in education, in many types of social activities and even political activities. But what I'm saying, and Neil Postman is actually, this is what I'm basing my argument on. He's saying that television has become a discourse which is actually forming or shaping everything that we actually do. It has affected the way courtrooms and law and judges and all those things in the US work. It's affected politics, it's affected education, because they are showing apparently a lot of videos during their education. But I think we have all experienced this, that yes, video is easier to watch, but it's not really as in-depth and as useful when it comes to something about the intellect as text. You can't deny, you can't really compare the capacity of video and text when it comes to serious stuff. So even compared to, for example, performance, which, I mean, speech is a form of performance. When I sometimes try to read out from a text, I'm much happier, because I don't feel that I forgot this and I forgot that, and it's very structured and it's very focused. But speech needs a kind of performative aspect to it, which empties the result of that performance from
the structure and the intellectual capacity that text has. So I'm not saying that you that video is bad or television is bad per se, but I think its dominance now in our culture and politics is dangerous because it's becoming, it's making democracy meaningless. It's really, it's radicalizing minorities and other dangerous groups, some dangerous groups. So I'm more focusing on the negative aspects, which I think, given how the world is, the shape of the world now is very important.
Hello. I wonder what you would think about the other side of the like contemporary internet, which is like the need of people of having contribution. Because what I'm, when you're saying that the internet becomes TV, I agree with you, especially when it comes to Facebook. But I have just one doubt, because what TV means for me is like passive observation, of course, like given by, like decided by someone else, which could be commercial, could be governmental, and of course based on preferences, prime time, what is better to sell, what is more difficult to sell, and so on. But you feel passive, you are a passive observer. And when I think about especially new social medias like Snapchat, Instagram, what I find like super important is the need of contribution and being active instead of being passive. So I wonder if you have any, I know of course it mostly it's like not very serious content, but it could be serious content. I'm not thinking about the content now, more about the attitude, which is I want to contribute, I want to be active instead of being passive and just receive the content from someone, something else. So I wonder if you have any thoughts on that, like this attitude of passive and active player in the internet, which in my opinion is very important for the new social medias like Snapchat or Instagram.
On Snapchat, I'm not sure if there is any possibility for any kind of interaction, because as far as I've experienced it, discovery part doesn't allow you to react, and the chats itself, the chats, so obviously it's a two-way communication form. So where do you see the interaction?
Because I want to watch other individuals being active, expressing their free thoughts instead of content which is somehow programmed by government or big companies or whatever. Yeah, it's like individual expression shared between people, maybe not in so interactive way, but still shared between individuals instead of one content which is kind of pre-given to watch.
Yeah, I think all of them are doing this. Facebook does live videos. It heavily promotes live videos where people can record anything and put it online. I mean, broadcast it simultaneously. But I don't see where, what kind of contribution it does to the socio-political scene. As a to the political discourse in all countries, it's a personalized television. It's a television that is only interesting for the people who know that person. It's the worst kind of television, I would even say, because it doesn't even have the attraction of television, which is professionally made. Each shot doesn't exceed 3 seconds or something like that. It's a festival of images and music, and you know, it's a whole different, it's a very developed form of visual communication now, television. So some of these things are quite primitive compared to what television has achieved now. yet they might be interesting to some people. The average of the views, I think, wouldn't be more than a few thousand. It's not comparable to anything on television. I would suggest everyone to read this. Because what I tried to say is much is articulated much better, in a much better way in this, apart from the fact that it was written in 1985, where internet didn't exist. But now I think all the arguments can be applied to the internet if you see it as a television. And this is my bit of argument, that internet is becoming television, and the rest is that. And he was a professor of communication studies. He wasn't someone, he wasn't a journalist or someone who would collect different things from different kinds of people. He is a theoretician and a historian of media. He used to be, and it's a fascinating read. And I'm sure it's translated into Polish, because it's translated into Persian a long time ago. It must be everywhere.
Hossein, so I will stay on the ground of be active on social media, and we get the message during the Arab Spring. I would like to go back to the past events.
Quote unquote. Arab Spring.
Yes, and we get the image of Arab Spring that it starts on social media. That like the role of social media in so-called Arab Spring was very significant. In one of interviews, you called the role of social media in so-called Arab Spring as a myth created by Americans. Can you elaborate more about that, and maybe it will explain as well what does it mean to be an active, and how we can understand to be an active on the social media, or is there is possibility to be an active participant in social political environment?
This is not what I'm saying, because I was absent. I was in prison when all these things happened. But I'm referring to Wael Ghanim, who is an Egyptian, and he had apparently a TED talk about how the social media helped, in the beginning, helped these movements to gather people and to organize people and to take them into the streets. But then, because of the very nature of the same social networks, they were lost. Their common causes, their common reasons were lost, and they started to fight each other rather than fighting for their common cause. And I think there is truth to it, because for a political movement, I think there needs to be a leader. Otherwise, it would be lost. It would be the interests of so many individuals would collide and would conflict so much that they cannot be unified anymore. And I think one example that, for example, the Iranian Revolution was successful in 1979 compared to the revolutions in the Arab world recently, was because it had a very strong leader, very charismatic and strong leader. So social media cannot act as a leader. It can act as a connector, but not as as a leadership.
You gave us hope when you said during your talk that contemporary art could be a platform for solution to fight against the social media, and as well to preserve the sense of knowledge production by the text and hypertext. Can you tell us more about your project, which you are currently working on, called Link Age? If you can tell us more, because I, as you described that project before, when we talked before this meeting, it seems like artistic, but as well, social engagement project.
I'm thinking of a collective sort of art project, which is called Link Edge, both meaning link dash age, the age of links or the act of linking, which could be also named as linkage. So there are some ideas to criticize the new form of social networks, the insularity, inward-looking, linearity, centrality, and all those things, all those negative aspects of social networks. So I haven't launched it officially yet, but I'm going to launch it soon, and I would hope that in collaboration with you we can actually improve it. And we are actually calling for proposals for anyone who thinks their art projects or ideas can be related to the to this idea. We would love to consider them and hopefully have them as part of the as part of the project. So it can also be even connected to because politically speaking, it's not a coincidence that now that we are observing a crackdown on open borders, we are seeing that open web is also in decline. There must be some sort of connection that immigration has become a problem, and I see the loss of diversity as a reason when we are not used to see to see anything different from us. Of course, you would. We would comfort ourselves in our own habits of our own race, our own religion, and we wouldn't want anyone to come in our own space, in our own closed space. So even it could be related to this aspect of the current sociopolitical currents of the world today. And it's if you look for linkage. It's based on the New Media Society Tehran, and if you Google linkage and my name, you could easily find it.
So we encourage people to participate.
If you have any ideas, yes, that could fit.
Thank you very much once again. The last questions from the floor.
From the videographer.
Yes, I'm not sure I can ask questions because I work here, but
I hope you wouldn't be
but I cannot do it. So I would like to disagree because you said that that you can't disagree stuff on Facebook, for example, because you actually can. Hate, just hate comment, you know.
Yeah.
And it's a kind of interacting. And second, I have you compared watching gameplay to watching baseball. And I have a 14 years brother, and he not reading at all. He's different than me because I'm actually 29. So, but you know, one day I realized he know a lot about history, really a lot, and he know it from rock, one. Adults who playing games and just making videos have vlog. This is called vlog, you know, video blog. and he actually plays and everything, you know, talking, and every time talking to your his audience, and he actually have influence for political political meaning of you know, words and other things to my brother. Actually, my brother sent me something, you know, about political influence to education and other, you know, really smart things that I don't know that my brother, you know, and I think that it's really valuable, and I disagree that video and the images are more less valuable than text, because video is my medium, and I actually happy that this switch, you know, about the switch on the internet, yeah, and yeah, so on.
Yeah, I would also suggest you to read this. Maybe you would be convinced by his arguments, because I think there is an essential difference.
Yes, I agreed. I'm agreed that it rules algorithm that this is something niebezpieczne, jak będzie. That algorithms are dangerous, and you know, it's about money, but I think it's not so, you know, white and black. I think there are really good, you know, things behind that, not only bad. And I think that you're sad because text, it's your medium, and it's something like that, close to that.
I also made a documentary, remember?
Oh, and it's a paradox that you showed us a video. So yeah, why you showed us a video? This is my question.
Entertainment, because I thought it would be boring to talk.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah, that's my whole point. If I had only shown this video, I think it would be much less challenging and thought-provoking than speech, and then reading would be the best. Reading the articles that I have written, or many other people have written.
Or watching a good film.
Sorry?
Or watching a good film.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If there is any other question, thoughts, which you would like to share with us, I would like to thank you very much for your talk and patience and time which you share with us. Thank you to audience to be with us tonight. And I would like to, I will stay in English, but I would like to announce another meeting which is a part of this program, Reorientalization of Islam, which will talk about switch religions and convert into the Islam from other religions, and it will take place on the 6th of October in this room at 6 o'clock. And you are more than welcome to participate in that meeting. And once again, Hossein, thank you very much for your time, and have a good evening.